The presence of mud was one of the most iconic traits of fighting on the Western Front. The overwhelming, omnipresent sludge through which trench lines were dug and in which millions of men would lose their lives. Mud was a powerful element, powerful enough to cease the marching of the strongest armies and grind entire campaigns to a halt. But it was so much more than just a logistical headache. It was a nightmare, an overwhelmingly claustrophobic, inescapable nightmare for those who faced it on campaign. We all know what mud is. We all learned in school about how its presence could slow down armies. But it was so much more than that. The hellscape of mud is, I believe, too little appreciated. So in this video, we're going to be discussing the role of mud in military campaigning through a wide variety of time periods, from the Napoleonic Wars up to the Great War, not by looking at the statistics, but by listening to the words of the individuals who dealt with it firsthand. For, as simple as an idea as it may seem, the terror of which I speak is something only truly comprehensible by those who were there. We'll begin our tour in Virginia during the winter of 1863, where the Union General Ambrose Burnside is attempting to cross the Rappahannock River. Now, you can read all about that campaign in your own time if you'd like to learn more about the who, what, and why of it all, but for our purposes, just know that this advance has been halted due to heavy rainstorms. And we're going to take up the ill-fated expedition, which became known as the Mud March, through the words of Jesse Bowman Young, a veteran of the war, in his book, What a Boy Saw in the Army. They were stalled by the mud. The bottom had dropped out of the entire region. Mud is no name by which to describe the sticky, miry, pitchy, unfathomable, and unexplored semi-fluid beds of stuff which filled and overflowed the roads, every one of which was transformed into an abysmal slough of despond. That army was literally stuck in the mud. Infantry mired, cannon bogged, horses stalled, wagons sunk axle deep in the squashy clay, everybody calling for help and no one able to render any, and the whole force of 100,000 men as absolutely helpless as though the rebel army had come upon them when asleep and bound them hand and foot. Here is a cannon deep in unknown depths of viscous and gelatinous slime mixed with an undercurrent of quicksand. A score of horses are hitched to it, and they flounder and sink to their bellies in frantic and ineffectual exertions, some of them drowning in the mud and trampled under the feet of the others, which with desperate tugs and struggles strive to keep a footing in the mire and do the bidding of their drivers, who urge them vainly out of the gulf of mud in which they have become inextricably mired. A strong rope is now hitched to the gun, and 50 men tug at it without taking an advanced step. The gun does not move. Another detail of 50 men is added, and the whole 100 pull with all their might and main, and with the same result. Still another detachment is brought, and 150 soldiers, brawny and stalwart, with shouts and curses and cheers and utmost endeavors, unite in the effort to pull the cannon out of the mud. But it will not budge. And there it stood. And there the army stood, bemired, covered with mud, enduring the storm, chilled to the marrow with the sleet and the piercing wind, out of rations and only 6 or 7 miles from their camps, and no way to get food, literally stuck in the mud. As we move through all these accounts, pay particular attention to the words witnesses use to describe the substance of mud itself, and how similar much of it can be. Mired in gelatinous sludge, stuck in abysmal semi-fluid slime, viscous, unfathomable, sticky, sucking, pulling, depths of horror. By the end of reading through all these accounts, a lot of them begin to blend together with just how similar they all sound. And if you think that I'm being dramatic there, let's look at another example from a different source a generation later. This one comes from the First World War, a book titled Mud and Khaki, again written by a veteran about his experiences. It is only after you have seen a battery of field artillery on the move in winter that you can realize at all the enormous importance of good weather when an advance is to be made. You must watch the horses laboring and plunging in mud that reaches nearly to their girths. You must see the sweating, half-naked men striving with outstanding veins to force the wheels round. You must hear the sucking cry of the mud when it slackens its grip, and you must remember that this is only a battery of light guns that's being moved. That's the thing about this particular horror is that it transcends any one time period, any one campaign or war. It's something almost universal to military history whenever there were armies, dirt, and water. The Siege of Sebastopol, for example, during the Crimean War, is often viewed as a sort of preliminary to the First World War, owing to the use of trench networks and the like, yes, but also owing to its terrible conditions that were brought about by cruel winter storms. In one letter home, Sergeant T. Going of the Royal Fusiliers would write from the trenches, "Dear parents, once more a few lines from this miserable camp. Mud, mud, mud. We have plenty of work in the camp, and 'tis bleak, cold work in the trenches, standing up to our ankles in mud and water, with hardly sufficient food to keep body and soul together." In another letter, he would describe how "we were standing nearly up to our knees in mud and water, like a lot of drowned rats, nearly all night. This is 10 times worse than all the fighting. We cannot move without sinking nearly to our ankles in mud. The tents we have to sleep in are full of holes, and there's nothing but mud to lie down in, or scrape it away with our hands the best we can, and soaked to the skin from morning to night. So much for honor and glory." Later on, the same book which recorded those letters would describe the British camp as "one vast sheet of mud, the trenches in many places knee-deep," and it would describe how men would die at their posts out of sheer exhaustion. And of course, that book, alongside all the other sources that I used in this video, are all going to be linked down below, mostly as free PDFs for if you'd like to read these sources yourself and learn more about the context and the like. And if you're interested in learning more about the Siege of Sebastopol in particular, my friend Daryl with the Ministry for History has an excellent video on that subject, which I strongly recommended, and that as well will be linked down below. But thus far, I've only covered so-called modern wars, Victorian and onwards. But these problems, they were far from limited to the days of steamships and rifles.
The French monk Michel Pintoin would write in the 15th century about how the French knights at Agincourt were weary even before the battle began, having to trudge through mud up to their knees. Roman soldiers at the Battle of Abritus in 251 AD would become stuck in the mud after chasing an enemy into a marsh and were cut down at range as a result. Even the biblical Book of Judges, chapters 4 and 5, describe the Battle of Mount Tabor. "And I will draw unto thee to the river Kishon Sisera, the captain of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his multitude, and I will deliver him into thine hand. The earth trembled, and the heavens dropped, the clouds also dropped water. The mountains melted from before the Lord. Then were the horse hoofs broken by the means of the prancings of their mighty ones."
It was mud. Mud which choked up the Canaanite chariots, which broke the legs of their horses. Now, as usual, biblical stuff, it's going to be a lot of different potential interpretations, and I'm by no means an expert there, but a lot of my basic searching, at least, like around like what people theorize happened, blah, 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 like whether it even did happen, all that sort of stuff, it all basically comes to the same conclusion that I've seen, that it was flash flooding and the resultant mud. This is a very common theme throughout history, and as armies only get larger and more complicated, as theaters of war widen and sources become more in-depth, even the men who were there are writing more about their experiences in greater detail and everything, well then those core themes only grow stronger. So let's return to an area that I'm more familiar with, lest I overstep myself. To the Napoleonic era, where Napoleon himself would come to detest what he classed as God's fifth element. The emperor's style of warfare, after all, was quick-moving. It relied on effective communication, rapid maneuvering, and being on the attack and everything. But in Poland and Russia, Eastern Europe, that's not always possible. One of his soldiers, Jean-Roch Cognier, I'm probably mispronouncing that name, but he would write about how,
"In the environs of Pultusk, the roads have disappeared beneath the waters and mud. One sees only wrecked carriages and horses buried to the belly. The 6-horse coaches of the emperor, in spite of all precautions, upset in frightful bogs, and it is necessary to lead a horse to one of the coach doors to enable the emperor to extricate himself from this dangerous predicament."
We have by now well seen how much of a nuisance mud could be to commanders and footsloggers alike. But dangerous? What does he mean by a dangerous predicament for the emperor? Well, the answer has been hinted at already, but mud could do an awful lot more than simply clog up supply lines. If the stuff was capable of swallowing guns and carriages, it could do the same thing to horses, mules, and men. And we'll learn more about that right after a word from this video's sponsor, Extra Wallets.
Hey there, Timmy. It's been a while since we've seen you. How's the soldiering life been treating you?
Well, truth be told, Brandon, I've certainly been better.
I'm sorry to hear about that. What's the problem?
I'm just feeling a little stuck, you see.
Oh, yeah, I understand that, Timmy. Life can be pretty tough sometimes. You know, it's okay to feel like you're a little stuck, you know?
No, I don't mean metaphorically, I mean that—
What I always find to be really helpful when I'm feeling down, it's actually buying an extra wallet.
Brandon, I don't think you're appreciating the seriousness of this situation.
No, what with those sleek designs and how efficiently they're able to carry all my cards and cash and everything.
Brandon, please,
Man, do I love this quick card access button. I mean, it's just so satisfying. It's easy to use, it's quick to access. I mean, that's why they call it the quick card access, am I right? And, I mean, to say nothing of how much easier it is to carry than a bulky old bifold sitting in the back pocket.
Yes, I understand the quick card access button and all the other little benefits. It's very cool, but I really could use some help right now.
Oh, no, don't worry. I've got you covered, Timmy. Because look here, when you use my link in the description, enter the code BRANDONF at checkout, you can get up to 30% off of that order. How's that for a deal?
It's a very good deal, but that isn't quite what I meant.
Well, anyways, I hope that helps you out, Timmy. Glad to see the life of a soldier is serving you well. And good luck in that battle with the French you got coming up, eh? Thank you to Extra for sponsoring this video. Now let's get back to the topic of mud. And all joking aside, how genuinely dangerous it could be for soldiers on campaign. Wait a second. Timmy? Timmy?
The mud we're talking about isn't just the stuff you'd find after a drizzle in your back garden. If you've ever walked across a freshly tilled farmland after a storm, that's a little bit closer. But imagine ground that's been churned up by hundreds of booted feet, by wheels, hooves, and even explosions. It's aptly referenced to as sucking mud because of how powerfully it forms a literal suction around you. It's viscous, it's deep, and it moves quickly. So much so quickly that entire cannon could be swallowed up before its crew really had the chance to react. Or, of course, worse. Much worse. Let's look at another account from the American Civil War, this one dating to 1862. A difficult night march through wooded swampland where regular raids by the enemy weren't the only concerns for desperate Union soldiers.
Everything seemed in confusion. None knew precisely where we were or where we were going. The miserable roads were choked with cannon, ambulances, and wagons. The denunciations of the drivers, the shrill cries of the affrighted mules adding to the horrors of the night scene. So great was the press that it seemed as though every vehicle was locked with its fellow. In many instances, the artillery, in attempting to pass these trains, became mired in the soft, soggy earth, sometimes being compelled to abandon a gun as it sank almost out of sight. Even the infantry found it difficult to gain firm footing, and for my own part, I was soon covered with mud and sand. Moving hither and thither in the darkness, we could hear the piteous cries of our wounded, yet we could not help them.
And we knew the next moment might see some of us added to their number.
If a marshland was capable of swallowing up entire cannon, think about what it might do to a person. And unfortunately, that isn't the sort of thing that we have to theorize on. It's something that happened, and it's something that we have a lot of first-hand accounts from. For example, from George Robert Gleig, in his account of the British Army's campaign against New Orleans in the War of 1812. A disastrous campaign even well before battle was met, as the army dealt with severe supply shortages, a horrible climate, sickness, and frequent enemy raids. The account is rife with heartbreak and privation, not the least of which when Gleig lost, of all things, actually a stocking, a single sock, when he fell in the mud and it sucked the article down so quickly and tightly that he was unable to retrieve it. Something that may sound a little silly, but when the army's baggage is so far behind, that meant that he had to go on with only one stocking for a couple of days, in freezing cold marshland, where the army couldn't even light fires because it had alert the enemy to their position. It was, in his own words, one of the most disastrous consequences of the campaign, his losing that stocking in the mud. But the quote that I really want to share with you has a far deeper consequence yet, as Gleick would lose much more than just an article of clothing.
All trace of a way had entirely disappeared. But not only were the reeds torn asunder and sunk by the pressure of those who had gone before, but the bog itself, which at first might have furnished a few spots of firm footing, was trodden into the consistency of mud. The consequence was that every step sank us to the knees, and frequently higher. That march was taking place at night, and without even moonlight to guide them, it was incredibly dark, meaning that it was difficult to select our steps, or even to follow those who called to us that they were safe on the opposite side. At one of these places, I myself beheld an unfortunate wretch gradually sink till he disappeared. I saw him flounder in, heard his cry for help, and ran forward with the intention of saving him. But before I had taken a second step, I myself sank at once as high as the breast. How I contrived to keep myself from smothering is more than I can tell, for I felt no solid bottom under me, and continued slowly to go deeper and deeper till the mud reached my arms. Instead of endeavoring to help the poor soldier, of whom nothing could now be seen except the head and hands, I was forced to beg assistance for myself. When a leathern canteen strap being thrown to me, I laid hold of it and was dragged out, just as my fellow sufferer became invisible.
It's because of accounts like that that I wear the poppy every year. Remembrance is something that means so much more than just the 20th century onwards. But lest you think that this is a phenomena restricted to the marshlands of the southern United States, let's return to Europe. Another of Napoleon's men, and heads up, this next quote does contain a brief reference to suicide.
In Poland, the roads are not paved. The trouble has been taking of tracing them through the forests, that's all. During the winter, and when the French army tracked over that country in all directions, we encountered oceans of mud which it was impossible to cross. The mud of Pultusk has become unhappily celebrated. Mounted men have been drowned in it with their horses. Others have been seen to blow out their brains, despairing of ever getting out.
And of course, 100 years later, armies were still dealing with these same problems, and worse. There are genuinely just countless cases of men, wounded or otherwise, drowning in mud on the Western Front, or being shot out of mercy to spare them that fate by their own comrades. It's better a bullet than a slow, choking, claustrophobic death. Sir William Beach Thomas, in his book With the British on the Somme, describes the pitiful state of warfare in the mud quite aptly.
Rain had fallen and reduced the carious particles to a state of foul swampiness, to a slough of despond, where men waded to the hips and only the strongest could cross. In this cockpit, the Royal Scots and others charged and struggled. They saw their wounded sink out of sight. A friend struggling to rescue a friend sank himself, and the two looked across at one another, each helpless. For a day and a night and a day, under the rain of heathenish shells and grenades, our men wrestled to turn these pits into fortresses and keep back the enemy from a few paltry yards of Flanders. Not once or twice have men been drowned from sheer weariness in the water of the trenches. These men were drowned in mud, in primeval slime. They fought like lions, a battle of eels.
So many of these terrible principles of what mud represented in warfare, both logistically and individually, would reach their zenith in the First World War. Because in the trenches, men weren't just marching through terrain in long columns, churning it up as they went. They were living in it. They were encased in it. It wasn't just water and dirt to be passed over. It was something else entirely, something more monstrous. Historian Matt Leonard offers an apt description how the mud was not just wet earth, but a combination of the many kinds of filth produced by war. In the dry, men still bled, vomited, defecated, and urinated. Water and food were still spilt in the trenches, and the earth contained the remains of thousands of rotting corpses and the ugly detritus of war. Drainage was not easy, and surface water would often remain in trenches and shell holes for days, harboring disease and death. Such nightmarish conditions could truly only be imagined by even the most troubled minds of Sebastopol or New Orleans. This was a mud that came to dominate man's senses in every way. His feeling, his sight, his smell, all of it just inundated, clogged up with mud.
Now the mud at Passchendaele was very viscous indeed, very tenacious. It stuck to you. Not only your putties were solid mud anyway, but it also stuck to you all over. It slowed you down. It got into the bottom of your trousers. You were covered with mud. And the mud there was, it wasn't liquid. It wasn't porridge. It was a curious kind of sucking kind of mud. Because when you got off this track with your load, it drew at you, not like a quicksand, but a real monster that sucked at you.
Describing the mud as a monster, a sort of beast, a living entity, it's a really common trend in the accounts that I've found from the Great War. It's difficult, I think, to really wrap one's head around how readily a person could be swallowed up by this earth, literally speaking. It's the sort of thing, I think, that can only truly be understood by the people who were there.
It was a nightmare, because all you had was a couple of duck boards side by side, and either side of it was about 10 feet of mud, 12 feet, with the top of a tank sticking out of it, here and there. And if you fell off it, it would take a traction engine to pull you out, almost. It was that deep. It was absolutely sucking mud. There were cases where one or two men slipped off the duck boards, and it took a couple of their comrades to pull them out gradually, inch by inch. Oh, you know, they managed to keep their arms out, and they pull them out inch by inch out of the mud and got them on again, on the boards again.
And the thing is that it seems many of the veterans were aware of just how impossible it was to describe these circumstances to those without that experience. Like, for example, all of us watching, I certainly hope. And as the army dealt with both criticism on the home front and even from well-meaning civilians, that misunderstanding could open up fresh wounds. It could open up traumas. Returning again to mud and khaki, the author has a lot to say about that particular dynamic of returning home and dealing with other people's opinions about what was going on.
Those at home in England, with their experience of war books and photographs of Zeppelin raids and crowded hospitals, are beginning to imagine that they know all there is to know about war. The truth is that they still have little idea of the life in the trenches, and as far as mud is concerned, they are delightfully ignorant. They do not know what mud is. They have read of Napoleon's fourth element. They have listened to long descriptions of mud in Flanders and France. They have raised incredulous eyebrows at tales of men being drowned in the trenches. They have given a fleeting thought of pity for the soldiers out there as they have slushed home through the streets on rainy nights. But they have never realized what mud means, for no photograph can tell its slimy depth, and even the pen of a Zola or a Victor Hugo could give no adequate idea of it. The mud, as the author describes, was endless, an all-pervasive entity of slime, like a dark god of otherworldly horror to the denizens of the trenches. He continues, "The plain of dragging slime that stretches from Switzerland to the sea is far worse to face than the fire of machine guns or the great black trench mortar bombs that come twisting down through the air. It is more terrible than the frost and the rain. You cannot even stamp your feet to drive away the insidious chill that mud always brings. Nothing can keep it from your hands and face and clothes. There is no taking off your boots to dry in the trenches. You must lie down just as you are, and often you are lucky if you have two empty sandbags under you to save you from the cold embrace of the swamp. This is not mud, such as we know it in England. It is incredibly slippery and impossibly tenacious, and each dragging footstep calls for tremendous effort." Unless you think the man was waxing poetic, plenty of others would describe the stuff in equally vivid detail, such as Eric Remarque in All Quiet on the Western Front, where he wrote, "The rifles are caked. The uniforms are caked. Everything is fluid and dissolved. The earth is one dripping, soaked, oily mass. Our hands are earth, our bodies clay, and our eyes pools of rain. We do not know whether we are still alive." Or Army Sergeant Robert Brefault, Mile after mile, the earth stretched out black, foul, putrescent, like a sea of excrement. It was one vast scrap heap. And scattered over or sunk in the refuse and mud were the rotting bodies of men, of horses and mules. Of such material was the barren waste that stretched as far as the eye could see. One newspaper, I believe it was a French newspaper, would even describe the mud as a terrible octopodal creature of sorts, luring in and killing soldiers by throwing out its poisonous slobber, blinding him, closing around him, and ultimately burying him. For men die of mud as they die of bullets, but more horribly, the paper would write.
And so at the last, we'll return one more time to mud and khaki, to the words of a man thoroughly accustomed to all of these horrors, words we all would do well to remember as students of military history. It is mud, then, that is the greatest enemy. It is the mud, then, and not faulty organization or German prowess that you must blame if we do not advance as fast as you would like. If we do not advance, or if we advance too slowly, remember that it is the mud that is the cause, not the German guns. Now, when I say military history, I do mean all of it. Obviously, the particularly hellish circumstances that all combined to create the Western Front are unique, and so you can't expect to draw precise parallels between it and say, 18th century military history. But I believe that everything we've looked at in this video speaks to a wider concern. That something which seems on the surface to be largely technical, something having more to do with numbers of supplies and how quickly lines move from one end of a map to another, is something which we so often discuss in such impersonal terms. It was for those who were there anything but. Mud was a logistical concern, yes, but what do those logistical concerns mean for the individuals on the ground? The people for whom the delay of a baggage train means they have to go without socks for days on end in freezing temperatures. Or who can't eat that day after marching for 20 miles. And then, even beyond the logistical elements of it all, there are much deeper considerations. That mud wasn't just a nuisance, it was a terror, a nightmare, a monster, the likes of which are nearly incomprehensible, unbelievable, were it not for the many accounts handed down to us through the ages. And ultimately that, I believe, is the point of military history, of all history, really. It's to understand, to appreciate, to respect, and even at times, to honor those memories on their own terms. Because every dry statistic, every dusty old map, behind it all, there were real people. Lest we forget. Thank you all for the time that you've spent with me here today. I hope you've enjoyed this video, and I hope that you learned something interesting. Like every YouTuber, I'd appreciate it if you left the video a like, or maybe offered your thoughts in a comment. And of course, if you're interested in helping me to continue producing this content, well then you can become my patron either on Patreon, on Ko-Fi, or now even through YouTube itself with a YouTube membership. All of those options help me out immensely well. YouTube does not pay as well as you probably think it does, so thank you all very much for your support, your generosity and all that, and of course until the next time, I am and I shall remain your most humble and obedient of servants.